حي على الفلاح.
So he made the announcement again. Who will go and face Jalut? Nobody responded except this young man. And for the third time, nobody came except him. Jalut said, then go. This young man was armed with a slingshot. With a slingshot. But he was armed with Iman and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart. He went up to Jalut and challenged him. Jalut said, I don't want to fight you. You are a kid. Send somebody stronger. I don't want to kill you, this young man said, but I want to kill you. And he put a small pebble in his slingshot and he shot Jalut. And Jalut was dead. He eliminated the king of the enemy and the battle was over. And this young man was Dawood alayhi salam. He was a young fighter in the army. After that, he was the one who inherited the kingdom from Talut. But this was built on the shoulders of these 314 men who fought in that battle. Just like the Khilafah was established on the shoulders of the 300 and so who fought in the Battle of Badr. That is how you establish Khilafah. It's not by talking. You establish it by the sacrifice. It's not an issue of numbers.
لكم لا تقاتلون في سبيل الله وما لكم لا تقاتلون في سبيل الله والمستضعفين من الرجال والنساء والولدان الذين يقولون ربنا أخرجنا من هذه القرية
Knowledge is meant to be applied. So who are evil scholars? Here is a rule, al-Shatibi, rahimahullah, said, إِنَّ عُلَمَاءَ السوء إن علماء السوء هم الذين لا يعملون بما يعلمون. إن علماء السوء هم الذين لا يعملون بما يعلمون. Evil scholars are those who are dangerous to mankind. They're a disease to mankind. They are those who don't act on their knowledge. Ibn al-Qayyim said in his book Al-Fawaid, evil scholars are like, he gave a parable. They're like people sitting on the gates of Jannah, calling people, come on in, come on in. With their tongues, they're saying, come on in, come on in. Their actions are saying, don't come in. The more they talk to people and tell people come in, the more their actions say, don't listen to us. Because if we were indeed truthful, we would have been the first to apply it. They appear like they are as though they're guides. Those ulama as-su appear. May Allah save us and give us refuge from that. They appear as though they are guides, but they are bandits. Those who don't apply what they learn are like bandits. It's like you're in your car, you're asking someone for direction. He gives you a detour so he can rob you. That's how ulama as-su are. Some of the worst parables in the Quran gives us to learn examples of, some of the worst parables are those examples to learn from are pertaining to those who don't apply their knowledge. وَاتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ إِنْ تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكْهُ يَلْهَثْ ذَلِكَ مَثَلُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا فَاقْصُصِ الْقَصَصَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. A scholar, فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ. A scholar, a alim, who acts different from that which he knows. Surah Al-A'raf. He is one, Allah gave a parable that he's like a dog. He said, had we willed, Allah says, had we willed, we surely would have elevated him. He's like a dog, but we would have elevated him. But he clung on to this earth and followed his vain desires. He didn't follow what he knows. The parable is a parable of a dog. If you drive him away, he lolls his tongue out. If you leave him, he lolls his tongue out. And whatever you do, whatever status he's on, he lolls his tongue out. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions, when he talks about this, he mentions how the parable of a dog is to evil scholars and then mentions 10 points under that. We don't really have time to go through them. Allah gives this example, not of any dog, but a panting dog, a lolling dog. He pants all the time. That's the worst of all dogs. Resting, tired, thirsty, with his thirst quenched, whatever status he's on, he's panting and lolling. If you tell the sheikh, speak the truth, he's panting and lolling. If you leave him, those evil scholars, to not apply what he knows he should apply, he's lolling. If you shun him, he's panting. If you just ignore him, he's panting. And if he speaks, he's panting. He did not use what he knows, so Allah gives him a parable of a panting dog. More than that, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُوا أَسْفَارًا بِئْسَ مَثَلُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. The likeliness of those who were entrusted with the Torah and likewise the Quran. The verse doesn't say the Quran, but likewise the Quran. But after that, after they were entrusted with the Quran, they after that failed those obligations, they are like a donkey, which carries huge burdens of books. Does he understand anything out of them? That's the example of the people who deny Allah's ayat. Here, Allah makes a parable to a donkey. The first one was a knowledgeable person, parable to a dog. Here, it's a parable to a donkey. لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا. A donkey which does not, you know, which does not carry. لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا. They did not carry it. What that means is they didn't apply it. What usage does a donkey get out of the asfar? The word in Arabic is asfar, which is plural for sifir, which are the big books or tablets that you used to write on upon. If you put them on a donkey, what does a donkey get out of carrying those asfar? What does a donkey get out of it on his back? But the weight. What does one who carries the Quran or Bukhari or Muslim or Mughni or Al-Sur al-Thalatha or other books, he carries it. He knows it. Carries it means he knows it. but doesn't apply it. What does he get but the burden of carrying it? You get nothing but the burden of the weight, just like the donkey. حُمِّلُ التَّوْرَاةِ Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما said, he was حُمِّلُ mean ordered to act upon it. They were given it, حُمِّلُ, in order to act upon it. Ibn Kathir رحمه الله said, this parable is for those who don't know what's in the books. They're given the books to learn, they don't want to learn. They don't want to learn what's in the books. Those who know what's in the books, they memorize it, but they don't comprehend it. They don't act on it. And it's also for those who know it and tamper and play around with it. They are worse than a donkey because at least a donkey has no intelligence to comprehend. They have the intelligence but don't use their intelligence, so they are indeed worse than a donkey. Ibn al-Qayyim in A'lam al-Muwaqqi'in said, even though this was directed to the Jews, it also applies to the people who were given the Quran and do not act upon that which is in the Quran. Wallahi, it's a grisly parable of a donkey. Allah comparing one to a donkey, to a dog. It's something to warn you. So one applies that which he learns and seeks knowledge and applies knowledge. These are reminders for those who have a heart or
جلجلت جلجلت عاليا في الأفق صيحة الأباء وانبرت وانبرت تسمع البغين أنغم الممات جلجلت جلجلت عاليا في الأفق صيحة الأباء وانبرت وانبرت تسمع البغين أنغم الممات قادمون كسنا الوهاج مسلمون ديننا المنهاج كسنا الوهاج مسلمون ديننا المنهاج المعالي سوف نمضي نشعل الأرجاء نورا ويقين للمعالي سوف نمضي نشعل الأرجاء نورا ويقين زمجري 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 أيها الأسد قد حق الجهاد واسألي 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 غير جيش الحق لا يجلو الوغاد بالسيوف نمحق الكفار والحتوف منية الأبرار بالسيوف نمحق الكفار والحتوف منية الأبرار فالمنايا فالعطايا فامضي للجنات لا تخشى المنون فالمنايا فالعطايا فامضي للجنات لا تخشى المنون الفاتحين بالجهاد الجهاد الجهاد بالجهاد سوف تعلو راية النصر المبين بالدماء نصنع الأمجاد والوغى ساحة الأسى نصنع الأمجاد والوغى ساحة الأسى لا نبالي بالأعادي عزمنا بالله مشدود الوثاق لا نبالي بالأعادي عزمنا بالله مشدود الوثاق مجدنا 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 قام بالأسياف صرحا من جلال نصرنا 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 لن يلوح النصر إلا بالنضال أقدموا عصبة الأشبال واصنعوا عزة الأبطال عصبة الأشبال واصنعوا عزة الأبطال هيا هبوا لا تهابوا عزمكم كالنار في وجه النقاط هيا هبوا لا تهابوا عزمكم كالنار في وجه الطغاة أن يهبوا لا تهابوا عزمكم كالنار في وجه الطغاة.
أخواني أنه سمعنا والله أعلم أنه يوجد في بعض البلاد الإسلامية أن الخمر يشرب علنا صحيح هذا؟
متواتر هذا.
صحيح؟
متواتر. أي نعم،
يعني يقولون باب السوق ويجعل في الثلاجات. ها؟ أعوذ بالله.
أنا يا شيخ رأيت هذا بعيني.
إيه؟
في بلاد الشام.
إيه؟
هكذا
في
كل مكان.
هؤلاء الذين يفعلون ذلك هل يقال إنهم مستحلون له أو غير مستحلين؟ ها؟ مستحلين له لا شك. كيف يرخص له هذا الترخيص العام وفي الأسواق ويعطى رخصة إلا وأنه يرى أنه حلال؟ لو رأى أنه حرام ما فعل هذا. وقد ذكر العلماء أنه إذا استحل الخمر فهو كافر، من استحل الخمر فهو كافر، إلا أن يكون حديث عهد بالإسلام لم ينشأ في بلاد الإسلام فهذا يعلم. لكن من نشأ في بلاد الإسلام يقرأ القرآن ويقرأ السنة ويسمعها من الناس ثم يقول الخمر حلال فهذا لا شك أنه كفر. وجاء ذلك مصداقا لقول الرسول: لا يكون أقوام من أمتي يستحلون الحراء يعني الزنا والحرير والخمر والمعاصي.
اللهم من أعان عبادك المظلومين والمستضعفين في الأرض فأعن، ومن نصرهم فانصره، ومن مد لهم يدا بالإحسان فامدد له يدك بالإحسان، ومن خذلهم فاخذله، ومن مكر بهم فامكر به، ومن مد إليهم يدا بالإساءة والعدوان فاقطع يديه واعم عينيه واجعله عبرة للمعتبرين يا رب العالمين.
So the Yahud, the Jews of Banu Israel, they have been a very mischievous people, causing fitna even before the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Jews always claim that Muslims, subhanAllah, were always making things up. We want to quote even from their own books about their very own mentality. And we need to learn about these people, because this is a people that we're going to always be dealing with until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends Imam al-Mahdi. These are the people that when it comes to the end of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would cause miracles for the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to see and hear with their own eyes and ears. Towards the end of times, when the Muslims will be fighting the Jews, the trees will speak, the stone will speak, and they will say, O Muslim, O believer, there is a Yahudi behind me, come and kill him. We see that the Jews, they killed many prophets, including Zachariah and John, who we know as John, or the Christians say John the Baptist, we say Yahya. And he said they were holding a position of wealth in the society, and they would use this wealth in order to have authority over the weak, just like they do today. You find that their hands are in everywhere, in businesses, in products that we should be boycotting, Coca-Cola and Nike and McDonald's and Starbucks, and the list is long. They had their hand everywhere, so they were in the media, as they do today. And they would use this against the weak. Another thing that they were very good at was they had one of the most oppressive interest loans. So they would give a loan to people that were in need that was impossible to pay back. Again, this still continues today, where we find the majority of banks are owned by the Jews. Peace is bad for the Jews. There's no business if the Muslims have peace, there's no business for us. There goes our media, there goes our Hollywood blockbuster films and whatever that's always targeting Muslims. And it's no good. So they need the fitna between the Muslims and the fighting, the infighting of the Muslims to continue in order to thrive. Who's in this fortress hiding like the cowards that they are? Like the cowards that they are today, hiding in their tanks, hiding behind their large walls. If you want to fight us, come fight us. You're going to meet men that you've never fought before. Now what are they doing? Hiding like the rats that they are. Nobody come and tell me, but brother, this is the Zionists, it's not really the Jews. There was no Zionists at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It was Jews, Yahud, and they were addressed this way. And I want to say, you know this, my dear brothers and sisters, that even these ultra-Orthodox Jews that you see today that are against Israel, and they hate the Zionists, we really know that from what we just mentioned, that they don't really have a unity. But these ultra-Orthodox Jews, who do you think they're waiting for? They're still waiting for their Messiah to come. And when that Messiah comes, they're still going to fight the Muslims. They're just not fighting the Muslims now. So don't be fooled to think that these people are still your friends. Yes, alhamdulillah, let them ride the wave and let them speak about the Zionists, about Israel, no problem. It's good for us. Enjoy the show.
So he made the announcement again, who will go and face Jalut? Nobody responded except this young man. And for the third time, nobody came except him. Talut said, then go. This young man was armed with a slingshot. With a slingshot. But he was armed with Iman and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heart. He went up to Jalut and challenged him. Jalut said, I don't want to fight you. You are a kid. Send somebody stronger. I don't want to kill you. This young man said, but I want to kill you. And he put a small pebble in his slingshot and he shot Jalut. And Jalut was dead. He eliminated the king of the enemy and the battle was over. And this young man was Dawood alayhi salam. He was a young fighter in the army. After that, he was the one who inherited the kingdom from Talut, but this was built on the shoulders of these 314 men who fought in that battle. Just like the Khilafah was established on the shoulders of the 300 and so who fought in the Battle of Badr. That is how you establish Khilafah. It's not by talking. You establish it by the sacrifice. And it's not an issue of numbers.